There are some men who inhabit this sense of entitlement. That entitlement is associated with the currently hegemonic form of masculinity. By hegemonic masculinity means the masculinity that tends to rule in a particular culture. That is, that men, some men believe that this is how men should be. And we said, of course, there are other forms of masculinity, more democratic, those that believe in negotiation, in kindness, in caring for others. But there is this idea that men have to be tough, have to be violent, have to have women. And so when women say no, when you see women, you say no. You as a man, you say no, I'm entitled to you. You cannot tell me what I can do. And you see this quite a lot, too often. And we have to, the idea then is to get men to understand that no, you are not entitled to women's bodies. You are not entitled to other men's bodies. And that takes more than just policing. It takes education. It takes public campaigns. It takes policies. It takes support in finances to change this idea that masculinities are, at least these forms of masculinities, and being a man is being entitled to women's bodies.
So in this case, Prof, is it safe to say that men resort to violence so as to ascertain that they still have authority in their relationships?
Absolutely. I mean, we have made the connection, so let's make it again. First of all, of course, in the society, in the world, in the majority of countries and societies in the world, they exist currently. Men tend to do this, that if men believe that men are in charge of society, of a family, of a neighborhood, or in a workplace, if you feel like that and somehow women challenge you, you can use a number of things, and violence is one of them. Of course, one of the things is money, right? So money is another access. But if you women have as much money as you, or have their own money, they don't want your money, and you feel entitled, you're going to use violence. So violence is, to put it clearly, violence is an attempt to reasset control, to reasset one's masculinity. That's the one part. Of course, there's another part to this. Some men who don't have access to forms of successful masculinity, so men who are not employed, men who think they don't have other means to show that they are men, will use violence to assert, not reassert, but to assert that they are in control. And that's where you see. So any tool that you can use, particularly your body or the guns or the knives or even shouting at women and threatening them, can be used to assert or reassert your control as a man.
Now, Prof, what is your take on the statement, men are trash?
Look, I have considered this both in writing and in a number of public platforms. Personally, I think it's an unfortunate statement. But let me quickly hasten to add this, that women have because of the violence that happens in this country, the numbers are just astronomical, too high, but also in other parts of the world. But so women use this to call attention to the trashiness, the trashy behavior of some men. But instead of just qualifying it in some men, this is no men, because we want to talk to you as a group. So if you have brothers, if you have fathers, you have children, you have to do the work, because we can't live in fear. So, yes. So in one sense, it's a generalization, but it comes from a particular place. Having said that, here's the third part to this. But personally, I really don't feel that much offended, right? Because I understand where it comes from. I understand that, you know, even if you personally, Gregory Copano, you're sitting there, you're saying, but, you know, I do the work. I do the work. I'm not violent. I treat women just as I would treat men. Equally, I listen. I'm working on this issue because I'm aware of inequalities, gender inequalities, and sexual inequalities. So I don't really take personally, but I've already mentioned these other two parts, that it comes from a certain history, a certain place. At the same time, it is a generalization.
Professor, just before we conclude, what would you say is an ideal way for a man to show emotion?
Well, men do show emotion. Let's start right there. Men do show emotion. But generally, in our society, in our culture, men tend to show a restricted number of emotions. Anger is one of the emotions that men are allowed to show in public, for instance. So they do show emotion. What you want to is to say, not to show these other emotions, especially those emotions that are called gentler emotions, softer emotions. You are restricting the humanity of men, right? What are these other emotions? These emotions such as gratitude, emotions such as joy, emotions such as love, emotions such as kindness, indeed emotions such as shame and guilt. So all these emotions that are softer, gentler, kinder, emotions other than the anger, are part of being human. If men don't feel this, or at least they don't express them out as much as women do, they are limiting their own humanity. That if you have done something, we have spoken earlier on about remorse, right? If you don't show remorse, if you don't show shame, if you're not thankful, grateful about somebody doing something for you, if you don't say you're sorry, you are really limiting your own emotion. So we have to bring onto the table in discussions with men the platform, spaces, to be able to express as many emotions as there are available in the world, including joy and love, particularly because we talk about children. I mean, kindness and caring. Caring is a big one. To show nurturance and caring is a big, big one in showing masculinity. So if you had to pick, for me, if you had to pick at least two or three emotions that men would support the work to do with men, all men in this country, but particularly those men who feel themselves that they are losing out in the war or the battle around masculinities. Here are the emotions. Love. Love is a huge thing. It's an amazing. I'm not talking about the love in movies that you see. Love for yourself, right? Love. You start by trying to understand yourself, and understanding is always connected to love. Is always connected to forgiveness. So love is a big thing. And then, of course, love for children, if you have them, your children, unconditional love. And then if you have a partner, whether this partner is a woman or a man, this idea that, you know, communion love, if not sexual love, of course, and of course, love for a friend, filial love. Love is a huge thing. I mean, we have to teach our kids, love yourself. And when they fully love yourself, of course, they start to understand. And so we're not talking about love in a narcissistic sense, that is self-regard, that you are the most important person in the room, that you are the most beautiful, you have the best clothes. I'm talking about a deep sense of understanding of yourself, of your own weaknesses, and love. That's the one part, one emotion that we have to teach men, love. The second part is related to that, of course, is kindness. Be kind. Men have to be taught kindness. Kindness to themselves, kindness to others. Kindness is a huge thing for me. It's an amazing thing. Be kind. Even if you are critical, for instance, critical against certain things, you might be critical against what I'm saying on this show. I might be critical against you, Gregory, about your thing. But even when you're critical, be kind. So don't destroy. Be kind. And kindness is a big thing. The last one, of course, comes right in the middle of something we take so much for granted from mothers, from women. Caring. You have to show care. And care in practical sense, but also in emotional sense. The practical sense, meaning changing nappies, to take care of someone, right? You're taking care of the child, you're showing care. Before you show care, you're taking care. You're changing nappies, you're washing the dishes, you're helping to prepare the food. You are doing the work of care. Care work, it's called care work, right? You're doing the... somehow people do this when they're in jail, and they make their own beds. When they come out of jail, or when they live in the mines, when they come home, they don't do this work of care. And then showing care, right? Care, in that sense, emotional care, hugging your children, you know, and that kind of care work, emotional care work is really important. I mean, these three things, care, kindness, and love. And of course, we can talk about other emotions. But even if just these three, these are really powerful emotions if one can inhabit them and use them to change oneself and change other men around one, and of course one's relationships, which will expand them to the world.
Professor Kopano Ratele, thank you so much for coming to the Internet Drive with Gregory Wetsmith. I wish you nothing but the best in all your future endeavors.
Thank you, Gregory.
That was Professor Kopano Ratele, renowned South African psychologist and an expert on men and masculinities. Now, today I'm not going to leave you guys alone, but with an artist from Swaziland by the name of Sizo. His full name is Sizo Dlamini, and he hit me up on Facebook asking me to play his lovely song titled Kuluma. Big up yourself, Sizo. That's it from me, Gregory Wetsmith. See you on the next episode of the Internet Drive with Gregory Wetsmith, discussing nothing but social issues affecting young people and young professionals. Here is Kuluma by Sizo.
Stamba solo waha hepsuku aglaleg. Bali solo wangshi na tongo ab nyaheli. Spanlo nung talang igme.
Now it's all a sit up and forever. I call